Welcome to Civilspedia. As part of today's discussion, we'll discuss Financial Stability and Development Council, Global Soil Biodiversity Atlas, and Parker Solar Pro as part of prelim, and the contributions of Sardar Vallabhai Patel as part of mains. And coming to Financial Stability and Development Council, it is a body established by a government notification in the year 2010, by a government notification as a body to institutionalize and to strengthen the mechanisms to maintain the financial stability, financial sector development, and inter-regulatory coordination. All right. And it is established through a notification. Therefore, it is not established by any law. It does not have any statutory backing. And it consists of chairperson and members. And Union Finance Minister is the chairperson. And the members are three ministries are involved. The members are Secretary of Ministry of Finance, Secretary of Ministry of Corporate Affairs, and Secretary of Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, and Secretary of Department of Revenue, Secretary of Department of Financial Services, Secretary of Department of Economic Affairs, and Minister of State, who is in charge for Department of Economic Affairs. He is also involved here. And Chief Economic Advisor of Ministry of Finance was also involved. And coming to regulators, for pension regulator PFRDA, the chairman of PFRDA is involved, and the governor of RBI, and chairman of SEBI, and chairman of Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India, the chairman of IRDAI, Insurance Regulatory and Development Authority of India. They are involved, and these are the members of this Financial Stability and Development Council. And coming to the responsibilities, as we have already seen, their responsibilities include maintaining financial stability, financial sector development, and inter-regulatory coordination, and also financial literacy, financial inclusion, and also macroprudential supervision of the economy, which involves functioning of large financial conglomerates, and also coordinating international interface with international financial sector bodies such as Financial Action Task Force and Financial Stability Board. And it consists of a subcommittee. This Financial Stability and Development Council consists of a subcommittee which is to be headed by RBI Governor, and Deputy Governors of RBI are also included in this subcommittee. With this, we come to the end of this Financial Stability and Development Council. Next, we'll discuss the Global Soil Biodiversity Atlas. I would like to clarify, in certain newspapers, Global Soil Biodiversity Atlas was stated as was prepared by Worldwide Fund for Nature, but it is wrong. It was actually prepared by European Commission's Joint Research Center in close collaboration with Director General for Environment and the Global Soil Biodiversity Initiative. And this Global Soil Biodiversity Atlas was prepared in contribution to celebrate the International Year of Soils, which was the year 2015. And the report has stated some potential threats to soil biodiversity, which are these. I am coming to the first point, the loss of above ground diversity, which means when there is change in land use pattern from a natural ecosystem to an agricultural system, there will be a reduction in number of species when compared to a natural ecosystem, and therefore which affects the soil biodiversity. And also the introduction of alien species. Generally, in natural ecosystem, there won't be any single species dominating the entire system. However, if an alien species or an exotic species is introduced, then there could be it could become a threat to soil biodiversity. And coming to pollution, we can say that oils, pesticides, chemical fertilizers, they all can damage soil biodiversity. Acid rain can improve the soil acidity, and thereby it can act as a threat to soil biodiversity. Nutrient overloading will also have same effect. It will alter the pH level in the soil, and therefore it is a threat to soil biodiversity. Agricultural practices includes pesticides, use of manures, chemical fertilizer, etc. And thus, it is also a threat to soil biodiversity. Overgrazing is the largest threat when we consider the grassland ecosystem. Similarly, fires, when it is arson or man-made, then it is also a threat to soil biodiversity. Coming to soil erosion, it is a natural process. However, when accentuated by human activities, all right, because of removal of vegetation cover, it can also lead to, it can also act as a threat to soil biodiversity. And land degradation and desertification along with climate change is also a threat to soil biodiversity. And this is the global map showing the distribution of potential threats to soil biodiversity, wherein they have classified five categories, wherein India comes under very high category, that is very high threat for Indian soil biodiversity. And this is about Global Soil Biodiversity Atlas. And with this, we'll move on to Parker Solar Probe. It was named after Eugene Parker, an astrophysicist who in the year 1950s have stated that stated or theorized about number of concepts related to how certain stars, including sun, liberate off energy or give off energy. And he called that energy that is liberated with rapid flow, rapid and voluminous flow as solar wind. He called that as solar wind. And coming to the mission duration, it consists of 6 years and 11 months, approximately 7 years, and said to reach within 3.9 million miles or 6.2 million kilometers from the sun's surface. And a previous record holder was Helios B spacecraft. And actually, Helios B spacecraft is 7 times farther than this distance. And Eugene Parker has also theorized explanations. This is the surface of the sun, and this is corona. Actually, the temperature in the corona is nothing but the outer layer of sun's atmosphere. The outer layer of sun's atmosphere is hotter than the sun's surface. And Eugene Parker has also given an explanation for this as well. And coming to, but that is actually a mystery. Why that difference, why the corona temperature is higher than that of sun's surface. Coming to the objectives, we can trace the flow of energy that heats and accelerates the solar corona and solar wind, and to determine the structure and dynamics of the plasma and magnetic fields at the sources of solar wind, and to explore mechanisms that accelerate and transport energetic particles. Coming to the major investigations which this particular probe aims to do, which is fields experiment, it will measure electric and magnetic fields in the near the sun's atmosphere and also close to corona, because that will help in identifying what is the reason behind corona heating. And also integrated science investigation of the sun. This will measure the energies of the particles of solar wind, which could be alpha particles, protons or electrons, and solar sweep investigation, solar wind, electrons, alphas and protons. It is going to count the abundant particles coming with solar wind, such as electrons, you know, highly ionized helium ion and highly ionized hydrogen ion. And highly ionized hydrogen. And wide field imager for solar probe or WISPER. It is the only imaging system that is available with this solar probe. It is going to image the solar wind and also the corona and also inner heliosphere. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. Nextly, we will discuss the major contributions of Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, as we all know, has played a stupendous role in integrating the princely states into an independent India. He has appeal to the princely states, rulers or princes of the princely states to accede to the Indian Union, particularly by surrendering three important concerned subjects such as defense, external affairs and communications. And he adopted various diplomatic tools for that. He provided privy purse and gave retention of titles. And also use patriotism and used public opinion In the beginning, he created this institution of privy purse would be given to this rulers or kings of princely states so that they can have their personal lifestyle without any deviance. And also this retention of titles for those rulers or princes who are very concerned about the symbols of respect, they can retain their titles, but they can merge or accede their territories to the independent India. And he also approached the rulers or the princes through patriotism to accede their territories to the independent India. And also he asked the rulers or princes to act according to the public opinion, which was primarily to accede to the Indian Union. And he also used a political tool to cover major princely states or bigger or larger princely states. So if we can convince larger princely states to join India, then all the followers of those princely states will also follow their trajectory and they will also easily join India. And however, using these methods, by 15th August 1947, all but three princely states joined India, and the three princely states which did not join India or accede to India by 15th August 1947 are Junagadh and Hyderabad and Kashmir. Coming to Jammu and Kashmir, the Maharaja Hari Singh was a Hindu king, but the subjects were predominantly Muslims, and this Maharaja Hari Singh chose to be independent. However, by October 22, influenced by Pakistan army officers, Pathan tribesmen entered or invaded Kashmir, and by October 24, 1947, and this Maharaja Hari Singh asked India to intervene in the process. However, according to Nehru and Patel, India can intervene only if Kashmir can sign instrument of accession to India. And thereby on October 26, Maharaja Hari Singh signed instrument of accession to India and appointed Abdullah as the head of the state according to the Indian demand. And then according to that instrument of accession, Kashmir became an Indian integral part of India. And coming to Junagadh, it's the place in Gujarat where the Nawab was ruling the princely state. However, the subjects were predominantly Muslims. Subjects were predominantly Hindus, overwhelmingly Hindus, who wanted to join with India. But Nawab has stated he is going to accede the territory to Pakistan, and Pakistan accepted the accession of the Nawab. However, the people revolted, overwhelmingly Hindu population who wanted to join with India. The people revolted and they made the Nawab to flee from the place, and they created their own provincial government. And India also sent the troops, and based on a plebiscite as advised by Sardar Patel, and the plebiscite was conducted in February 1948, and the plebiscite was overwhelmingly in favor to join India. And with that, Junagadh was acceded to Indian territory by February 1948. And the third territory was Hyderabad. The Nawab of Hyderabad, the Nizam of Hyderabad was having the plan to be an independent ruler, not to join Pakistan, not to join India. However, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel was focused on acceding the territory of Hyderabad with India, because without Hyderabad, India will not be politically unified as a geographical entity. And therefore, but the Nizam of Hyderabad was delaying the negotiations with the Indian government. However, the Nizam was also strengthening himself on military front. He was also importing a lot of arms, but he did not know what is writing on the wall, what is going to happen in future. And therefore, by September 1948, because there were oppression among the peasants and farmers in that Hyderabad princely state, and many peasants started to leave that particular state and to flee that state and to displace to various other parts of India. And therefore, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel under Operation Polo has taken police action in the state of Hyderabad, and therefore to liberate the state of Hyderabad in September 1948. However, formally Hyderabad, the principal state, acceded to Indian territory by November 1948. And thus all the princely states, almost more than 550 princely states, were acceded to India through the significant efforts taken by Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel along with his secretary for the Department of States, Sri V.P. Menon. And he is also the architect of steel frame of Indian administrative machinery, which is nothing but All India Services. And here he considered he was the chief protagonist of this All India Services, because he considered it will act as a cementing force, to promote unity and integrity in India, and thereby it will never allow a possibility of disintegration of Indian Union because of centrifugal tendencies or divisive or separatist intentions. And he is also called as father of Indian civil services, and we'll now look into the various satyagraha that he was part of, and he was how he supported the peasants. Particularly, he supported peasants in Keda satyagraha, Borsad punitive tax satyagraha, and Bardoli satyagraha. In Keda satyagraha, which happened in the year 1918, where already the peasants were distressed with plague, drought, and failure of crops, but then they were requesting for remission of land revenue, but then the British Indian government was not ready to give that remission of land revenue, and therefore the peasants approached Mahatma Gandhi and others, and the Gujarat Sabha played the lead role in organizing this Keda Satyagraha, for which Mahatma Gandhi was the president. And it is during this time the young lawyer Sardar Vallabhai Patel joined with Mahatma Gandhi, and he toured with Mahatma Gandhi to various villages to instill confidence among the people not to pay the tax, not to pay the land revenue. And finally, the success of the Satyagraha is that Keda Satyagraha is that finally British Indian government allowed only those persons who could pay this land revenue. And coming to Nagpur flag satyagraha, it was the leader of this satyagraha was Sardar Vallabhai Patel, held in the year 1923. The purpose was to violate the law by hoisting national flag, because at that time hoisting Indian flag is an offense, and that too by non-violent civil disobedience. That is satyagraha, and the nationalist should not resist police arrest and should not retaliate the police force. And coming to Borsad punitive tax satyagraha in 1923, this was also organized by under the leadership of Sardar Vallabhai Patel. What happened here was that the British Indian government has imposed a punitive tax of around 2.4 lakh rupees on the population living in Borsad, stating that they were hiding or harboring criminals. And therefore, the peasants asked the Mahatma Gandhi and also the Sardar Vallabhai Patel, who helped them, who asked them to not to pay the amount, and also convinced and finally organized this satyagraha, where 1924 January 4, the British Indian government revoked such a tax. And coming to Bardoli satyagraha, held in the year 1928, the officer responsible to collect land revenue increased existing land revenue by 30%, which cannot be paid by normal peasants, and therefore the peasants asked the leadership of Sardar Vallabhai Patel, and Patel came and visited the people in Bardoli. Bardoli is a place in Gujarat, and Patel has written a letter to Governor of Bombay at that time to conduct an independent inquiry whether it is reasonable to have this 30% increase, whether this increase is justifiable, or he will ask the people not to pay the land revenue. And finally, because of the success of Satyagraha, the British Indian government in the year 1928 has conducted this independent inquiry, which found it is unjustifiable to have such increase, and finally they reduced the increase to 6.3%. And with this, we come to this end of this discussion about Satyagraha. And he was also chairman of Provincial Constitution Committee, Advisory Committee on Fundamental Rights, Minorities and Tribal and Excluded Areas under the Constituent Assembly. During the interim government in 1946, he was holding the portfolio of Home, Information and Broadcasting. And in the first cabinet of Free India, he was holding the portfolio of Home, Information, Broadcasting and States. And as a tribute to the national leader whose iron will is to unite India by any means, particularly the more than 550 princely states into one single union, and therefore he is called as Iron Man of India for his iron will to make India one nation, by accessing, by integrating all the princely states with India. And coming to the tributes, it is a tribute that in the year 1974, the National Police Academy was named after him. And in the year 1991, he was posthumously conferred the highest civilian honor in India, Bharat Ratna. And yesterday, Statue of Unity was unveiled by Prime Minister, and which is the tallest statue of India, recognizing his iron will to promote unity and integrity in India. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. Kindly like, comment, and subscribe our YouTube channel for more videos. Thank you.